I should have mentioned that I'm also a member of Lawyers for Choice, and if any of you are lawyers or legal academics or law students, we welcome new members. You can just email lawyersforchoice@gmail.com. Normally I would do some sort of feminist thank you for about 5 minutes initially, but I realise I don't have that time, so you can just sort of take it for granted. I'm not going to talk so much about international human rights law because the people who've come before me have talked so well about it. I'm going to talk a little and very quickly about Irish law and what the amendment means for us and how we should get rid of it and what we should replace it with. I think you're probably all familiar with the idea of the Eighth Amendment already, so I won't go through that. But I don't think we often appreciate just how much of an impact those small few words have on a variety of issues in Irish law. We talk an awful lot about the text of the Constitution, reforming the text of the Constitution, but the Eighth Amendment is almost unique because it requires doctors and civil servants and government lawyers and so on to apply it on a fairly regular basis, or envisages that it will be applied on a fairly regular basis. You know, every doctor his own chief justice in a way, because we require the test from the X case, which in itself is derived from the Eighth Amendment, to be deployed and analysed and taken into account, not just in abortion cases, but in any kind of case of maternal-fetal conflict, in any case where a woman's life might come to an end as a result of her pregnancy. So the first thing that we're familiar with that the Eighth Amendment does is that it prohibits abortion except where the pregnant woman's life is at real and substantial, not immediate, not inevitable risk, and the abortion is the only means of eliminating that risk. So that test is obviously very abstract. As has been pointed out several times before, we don't have, or doctors don't have, any significant guidelines on how they should be applying that test in concrete cases. And, you know, we've said this before, that doctors have been put in an impossible position. And we're familiar with that idea of evaluating risk. It comes up a lot in public discourse. But much less attention has been paid to the second part of the test, at least in public discourse, that the abortion can only be given if it is the only way of averting the risk to the woman's life. And that's what appears to have happened in Miss Y when we talk about this caesarean section, that clinical best practice in Ireland, C-section potentially getting orders to compel hydration and so on, that is clinical best practice within the meaning of the Constitution. That's what the Constitution does to clinical best practice. The other thing that it appears to do is it appears to create a kind of presumption in favour of live birth at all costs. And that, I think that's a really useful campaigning point. And I think it's something Irish women are becoming aware of. This is not just an article in the Constitution about abortion. This is an article about maternal care, which inserts a presumption into Irish medical practice of live birth at all costs and of induction as the method of abortion if abortion has to take place. And that cannot be, that is not a practice that can be consistent with regard for the avoidance of harm to a woman, regard for the avoidance of subjecting women to inhuman and degrading treatment and so on. I think that should be obvious. And I think that's a good... So when we think about stigma around abortion in Ireland and that abortion is something only certain kinds of women will need, even, you know, good Irish women who do the good Irish Catholic thing and go and have a couple of babies, it affects you too, right? And I think it could affect you too, and I think that's a key point for everybody to understand. Obviously, the way in which the Constitution has been interpreted is very restrictive. When we were talking about the last act, a number of us said that you could legislate for foetal abnormality within the meaning of the Constitution, that unborn implies capable of being born alive and capable perhaps of surviving for some period after the birth. And that was ruled out. We wouldn't legislate for foetal abnormality. That is a very restrictive interpretation of the Constitution, and it's actually evident of what's gone really badly wrong with this amendment. This amendment has become unworkable at the constitutional level. It is so, it's become so rigid, it's become so fossilised that it's incapable of expansion or adaptation to real human needs. And that's the real reason it has to come out. It's not just that most of us in the room were too young to vote for it. It's not just that it is born of an almost uniquely dysfunctional series of political processes, particularly when you read it across the referenda, the three referenda. Sandra McAvoy's work is really brilliant on this. It's that as a matter of constitutional principle, we can't use it anymore. It's broken, it's dead, and it needs to come out. We did that with the children's rights referendum. if I wanted to be a little bit more racist about it, I could say we did it with the citizenship referendum. People who advocated for the citizenship referendum said we needed that referendum because judges had gone too far in their interpretation of the Constitution by giving certain rights to migrant children. This is an argument. When the Constitution, this is an argument that's open to all kinds of interpretations, but when the Constitution fails, we change it. The Constitution is broken, that's why we're going to fix it, that's why we're going to repeal the Eighth. The final thing, as Colm pointed out, is that the government uses the amendment as a block on our proper democratic engagement with EU law, ECHR law and international human rights law. They make a kind of a cultural defence argument. We're special, this amendment is the will of the people, even though there are plenty of arguments to say that it isn't. And we need to pull it out so that Irish women can have access to the rights that their counterparts in other countries under the umbrella of the ECHR and the European Union have access to. So do we need to get rid of it? Yes, because of the way in which it defines and protects unborn life. Yes, we do, because that's unworkable. If the government doesn't want to legislate now, it's important to bear in mind that there are lots of things it could do in the meantime. It could decriminalise abortion. It could significantly reduce the sentence, which I think somebody said earlier is quite rightly one of the highest in Europe. It could tell us, although this will be giving the game away, the circumstances in which somebody might actually be prosecuted under that legislation. Is the government actually suggesting that somebody who takes a pill at 8 weeks, for instance, would be whacked with the full sentence of 14 years? That cannot be the case. The threat of 14 years is a chilling effect and it's a moralising tool, but that cannot be the case. The government should be able to clarify that as a matter of criminal procedure. They could legislate for foetal abnormality now. They could sort out the delays and inefficiencies in the Protection of Life During Pregnancy Act. We are still in breach of the ECHR, by the way. That's what Ms. Y demonstrates, that entitlement is still inaccessible, that we still need reform on that. We could have a Maternal Care Act, which would lay out, beyond all doubt, that treatment of pregnant women is with their consent and with their consent alone, and that decisions may not be made on some spurious unarticulated ground. We don't know what arguments were made by the state and the HSE and the lawyer on behalf of the unborn in the High Court when they applied for hydration orders and a C-section. We don't know what arguments were made and what the High Court said back, and the HSE inquiry terms of reference will not give us those answers. So there is a very obvious need to legislate around maternal healthcare and to legislate around consent within the healthcare system more broadly. And of course, finally, we could close down direct provision, which was a big issue in the case of Ms. Y and cases like that. If we do get rid of it, I think the simplest thing is to cut it out. Let's not replace it. Let's just remove it completely. And let's see what's left in the Constitution then. There probably still is a right to life of the unborn, to be honest, but it would probably look something much more like respect or dignity, not an absolute limit, okay? Women do, though you wouldn't know it from the abortion jurisprudence, have rights to autonomy, bodily integrity, freedom of conscience and so on, but they have been left undeveloped in the abortion and maternal care context because of the right to life of the unborn. So I think take it out and let's see what blooms in the gap, but bear in mind there will be very little litigation because quite reasonably and because as a matter of procedure it is very difficult for pregnant women to bring these cases. Let's bear in mind that most of our abortion jurisprudence comes from a campaign of litigation undertaken by Spock in the late 80s and early 90s. What would we replace it with? Please not rape, incest and foetal abnormality. And I'm really heartened to see that at least in this room, I'm not going to have to make that argument terribly strongly. Foetal abnormality should not even be an abortion issue, right? And termination for medical reasons have made this argument again and again. If we put that in the same act with you know, women with unwanted pregnancies who need to end those pregnancies for various reasons, the peculiar treatment needs of women in the foetal abnormalities position will be used to cloud and cover and undermine the rights of women in other positions. That needs its own legislation which will reflect proper compassion and dignity for those families and those women. Not a rape exception. Look at how we're treating suicidal women. Are we really going to put in a rape test, a legislative rape test? In in other countries, Poland, for instance, case before the ECHR, and lots of South American countries, the rape must already be the subject of criminal litigation before you can make the report. Now, obviously, that's problematic for reasons of delay, for reasons of the pressure that can be put on the woman, and because we do not have a great legal attitude to rape in this country anyway, to say the least. That is unworkable. We cannot do it. And for feminist reasons, we cannot have legislation based on categories of deserving and undeserving women. So, so at a minimum, at a minimum, we need to be talking about a physical and mental health exception, not one as restrictive and clouded as the one in Northern Ireland, where it must be grave and permanent risk, almost unworkable as well. That will get us out of the situation that we saw in the case of Savita Halappanavar, where doctors are kind of engaging in this kind of brinkmanship. You know, are you dying enough yet? Are you suicidal enough yet? Right? And no, I mean, I think it's worth mocking. I think it's absolutely, it's unworkable and it's ridiculous. I would argue for, consistent with European best practice, 12 weeks of abortion on request and grounds thereafter. And maybe there are arguments for even a slightly longer earlier period, but certainly a period of abortion on request. I think that's the reasonable solution. I don't know whether we'll get it. In the alternative, I think health grounds are essential. We can't add on some extra things and leave the life exception as it is, because that's just creating more rubbish on top of the existing rubbish that we have. I think we need to watch Northern Ireland very closely. What happens there will obviously impact women's options down here. I think if we have legislation, there is an argument, and this is partly Ruth Fletcher's argument as well, there is an argument for inserting decision-making principles for doctors into the legislation to remind them that women's autonomy, dignity, conscience, and right to freedom from inhuman and degrading treatment matter. Human rights-oriented training for doctors would be amazing, and I know lots of people who would provide it for free, right? And the very last thing, two last things, I think the slogan clinical best practice is abused an awful lot by anti-abortion campaigners in Ireland. I think during the last legislation we did not scrutinise enough, we didn't ask the right questions about what clinical best practice meant in particular life-threatening situations, and we need to ask those questions properly. And the last thing is, if we are going to start providing abortion services properly in this country, and we're going to treat people like the IFPA, I've been doing a different project on the history of organisations like the IFPA, heroes, right? A heroic organisation. If we are going to have to start providing abortion in Ireland, we need to think about how we are going to protect the people, the organisations, the doctors, who are going to put their heads above the parapet first. This cannot be a question of passing the buck, as we did, for instance, with contraception for decades. We have to think about, ethically, all of the agents who would be involved in providing that service. So thank you for listening, and I'd love to hear you.